one of the largest companies in the world. Do you think that you have a responsibility to speak out about issues like internet regulation?
I don't think anyone comes with a responsibility just because their company is really big, especially since I'm not the one who wanted to run a company, just be a great engineer that helped start it. So I don't feel that anybody has a responsibility. However, I do like it when well-known people that are in the public eye speak out on social issues and give their opinion.
What do you think about legislation like SOPA and PIPA, and why do you think that they were so unpopular?
It turns out that the internet, when it first came, it was a breath of fresh air. It was so free. Nobody owned the internet space. Countries didn't own it. They didn't control it. It was worldwide. It was people to people. It was like we little people of the world all of a sudden had this incredible resource, and we didn't have to go through other people selling it to us and delivering it to us. That has changed a lot, but still, those were items that were kind of against just being able to use the wires to send whatever you thought of to somebody else who's a friend or whatever, sharing data. So a lot of people have done that sort of thing. They have freely shared a song, maybe a song with a son, or maybe they've shared another file with another good friend, and they just don't want interference. Now, sure, it's illegal to share copyrighted material. Fine, there are laws in place. But these were new laws that were going to just totally try to put up roadblocks to services that had other very good purposes in our life. For example, I might make a promotional video for an interview like this, and then I'll email it to you. Well, it's too big to email. So I'll upload it to a little site. Maybe it's Dropbox. Maybe it's my Apple iDisk. Maybe it's Megaupload. I'll upload it to a site and send you the URL, and now you can download it. And I do that regularly.
I heard you previously talking about Kim.com's case, and you mentioned that the charges against him were pretty much phony. Elaborate more on what you meant by that.
Yes. First of all, he ran one of the largest file sharing services in the world, so the most movies and all were being exchanged by people through that site. It's not a site where you could connect to it and say, search for Avatar. There was no searching. Somebody could upload a file and then pass out a URL on their own. And they're violating the law if it's copyright material, like a movie. And the person who downloads it is violating a law too. But what Kim.com ran is just a service that's like a post office. He was the post office it was being mailed through. Why do you shut down the post office thinking that's where the problem is? It's not. So that was a phony charge. They tried to charge him with copyright violation himself for uploading 60 songs or something, but they had come off of CDs he had purchased. So you see, it was all these attempts that I call phony. Then they had to figure out a way to extradite him. They needed a crime that would get him 5 years in prison to meet the law, the New Zealand law for extradition. So they made up phony charges of racketeering, like he's some big mobster connecting, you know, a big financial empire in all these countries. I mean, Apple does that, but Kim.com is just a nice, soft, little sweet guy when you meet him who tells the truth openly. You know when somebody's being truthful when you're with them personally, and he doesn't hide things. He doesn't share. He doesn't have concocted lines to tell. He's not a racketeer. They charge him with mail fraud because he said, I deleted some files, and what he had done was delete the links to them. It's like if you have a computer and you take a file and you throw it in the trash, the file is still on your hard disk. It didn't really get erased. The link is gone. You can't find it anymore by that link. So that's a phony charge. He really had gotten rid of the one part you could get rid of to make it look as though it was deleted. The phony charges just indicate that they're doing everything they can to make the public think the prosecutors, are in the right, you know, but you don't do phony things when you're in the right. You have an open and shut case. No, they're having to go beyond the bounds of what's right to try to convict him.
What kind of precedent do you think this sets for just government overstepping?
I've read a lot about how they confiscated his data files, actually took him to the United States, and they didn't have the right to do that. The trouble is we developed what sort of rights you have to have against accusers, meaning the police and the prosecutors. They are the accusers. Presumption of innocence means the burden of proof is on the accuser. They have to prove things. You have the right to be notified what you're being charged of. You have a right to, a lot of different rights that make sure you're being treated fairly. And prosecutors and governments have found every way they can to get around those rights. And that's what bothers me, is that, if they want to convict you of something you didn't do, they have an awful lot of techniques to do it, a lot of ways to do it.
You founded the Electronic Frontier Foundation to protect free speech. Should the principles of the First Amendment be protected with something like WikiLeaks?
Free speech is not absolute, in my mind. It's a very important right, It has to go through considerations of, did you violate it in ways that might be hurt somebody else? Some free speech could actually trigger harmful events. It could trigger even murders. So does murdering an abortion doctor count as free speech? No, there are limits to free speech. I don't know, in the case of WikiLeaks, I don't know where that's gonna fall out.
So you think there are limitations in terms of kind of opening or protecting all free speech online and the war on whistleblowers?
Well, all, yeah, free speech online. I was brought up with the belief that the First Amendment was such a good thing. Every one of our Bill of Rights in the United States was so crucial to my heart, the way my dad taught me. But free speech meant you could say something bad about the president even. You could say something bad about your government. You had that right, and we were taught you don't have that right in communist Russia. So I believe in that right very strongly. As far as WikiLeaks, you know, I wish I knew more about the whole case. For on the surface, it sounds to me like something that's good. The whistleblower blew the truth. The people found out what they, the people, had paid for, you know, and the government says, no, the people should not know what they paid for.
Growing up in a generation where you've seen the internet proliferate into something so massive, and where political and social movements are birthed online now, what do you think just about the evolution of the internet and how, you know, Apple has really played a role in expanding that to people?
You know, when we started the company, I always go back to that point, did we have a vision of computers being prolific in everybody's hands throughout society? Yes. Did we have the idea that it would lead to, you know, the incredible connection that the internet would come on board, that broadband would come on board for almost everyone who wants it? And that would lead to all these, you know, basically the way we live life and the way we do things, everything political, everything social, the way we do things with other people is all done with your computer, on the internet, with your iPhones, with your mobile devices now, and it's a totally different world than it was when, well, we had powerful computers, but they weren't a part of your life as much as now. And I'm just as happy as everyone else to see it having turned out this way.
How do you see it going? Do you think that it will still continue, or do you think that we'll see kind of a curb? I mean, with the political and social movements now where everything's integrated, everything's being homogenized in the entire world, and we're seeing the Arab Spring, the Occupy Wall Street movement, really because of social interaction.
Yes, I think that a lot of social interaction will be curbed. Let me take that back. I fear it. I fear it will be, that the gatekeepers, those who can turn on and off switches, allow certain things, disallow other things, allow who gets to send me data about a new movie rather than everyone have an equal say-so of reaching me. Yeah, I fear that very strongly, that especially net neutrality, issues like that, internet freedom is being interfered with in major ways, and it shouldn't. I think the internet should have been considered from day one a country of its own that isn't bound by any individual country's laws. Maybe we could have had an internet government, but it didn't happen, just like world government doesn't happen. You know, space doesn't belong to anyone. The moon doesn't belong to anyone. These are really beautiful principles in life, and then as soon as a country figures out a way to get control of them, it disappears. I'm an optimist, and I believe we can move more and more towards net neutrality. The trouble is, a lot of it has to be enforced by the government, and conservative types and libertarian types say government shouldn't have any say and control over that. That takes away our freedom. Wrong. It takes away the freedom of the companies that are taking away the freedom from us. Every freedom we have in the United States, every one of them, was given to us by congressional regulation. It's called the Bill of Rights. That is what gives us our freedom, and yet it was from the government. It was government regulation. No, there are times when government regulation says you will not impede with the internet neutrality of the users.
What do you think about this whole hacktivism movement that's come out of kind of, you know, the war on whistleblowers and the Occupy Wall Street and Anonymous, and you have, you know, these takedowns of government websites, and then you see legislation like CISPA, the Cyber Intelligence Security and Protection Act, that kind of puts a stop to these things. Do you think that that's kind of working as a guise and using the hacktivism and hacktivists to kind of regulate the internet even more?
So I really think that there are means for legitimate discourse, and trying to bring attention with activist acts is wrong. On the other hand, I believe very strongly in legitimized marches and that sort of stuff. You know, with the approval of the authorities, there's room in our society to go out and have a microphone and to have a say and be heard by so many others, especially in this day of the internet. So there are a lot of avenues. It's just trying to, you know, grab something to get on the news. And I don't think that's the way to, maybe it's a start. It puts ideas in people's heads. But I really, I don't think that's the right way to solve things.
I know you said before that no one really has the responsibility to speak out about anything. But why do you, Steve, why do you speak out, and why do you think so many others don't about these issues?
You know what? The whole world's very conflict oriented. We want to take a side and fight for my side. My side might be my country. It might be my computer platform. It might be which browser I use. And I take my side and everybody else is bad and I want to fight it. And I only want to look at the world one way. And I try to be so wide and open and just, you know, accept everything and judge it. That's the logical scientific, you know, approach. Don't take a side. Don't be like for one religion against others, that sort of thing.
Thank you so much for your time.